Hi, my name is Dakota Lamb, and this past summer I had the opportunity to study abroad in Ireland for just over a month, and I did some research on renewable energy and specifically wind turbines and how the public opinion in Ireland is shifting away from wind turbines, as there is this increasing debate on whether or not a green land is more important than preserving a green landscape. So in this presentation, I'm going to start off by giving you an overview of the current status of renewable energy in Ireland. And you can see it's about a third of their electricity generated is coming from renewable sources, which is 10% more than coal. And if you break that 27% out into its own category, the vast majority is coming from wind farms at 21 of the 27%. But it's important to consider that electricity is only a third of the total energy use in the country. You have to account for heating and transportation as well. And it's important to think of it like this, because this is how the European Union measures compliance with goals in accordance with the Paris Climate Agreement. And so you can see on this chart that Ireland has a specific goal, as do all of the member countries of the EU. And by 2020, they have to be at 16% renewables out of all of their total energy, and as of 2016, they're only at 9%. So they have a ways to go in the next few years to avoid those fines by 2020. And that's going to be difficult because there is an increasing opposition to wind turbines among the public in Ireland. And this was something really hard for me to wrap my head around when I first got there, because I had images like this of wind turbines, which I'm sure many of you do as well, of these sprawling landscapes, these massive wind farms in the agricultural parts of our country, where they're not really impacting residential areas. They're in open spaces, they don't really bother anyone. But that is not what it's like in Ireland. These turbines are built right up to homes, very close, they're in towns, and for a country the size of the state of Indiana, they just don't have these open spaces to put these wind farms like we can away from residential areas. And so this has become a really big debate among the Irish people. If you're wondering how serious this debate is, several times while I was there, they had these primetime, hour-long, commercial-free debates on the major news channel with someone from the wind power industry against someone who is opposed to it. And so if you're in Ireland, you have an opinion on wind turbines, which is not something that we really have here. So there's three main reasons for this debate. And the first is wind turbines getting too close to homes, and the idea that this could negatively impact the property value of those homes. This is something that the wind power industry vehemently denies. They say there's no evidence that property value decreases just because you can see a turbine from that property. However, you do have to consider some of these possible effects. Shadow flicker is one of them. When the sun aligns just right behind the blades of the turbine, those blades move in front of the sun and cause this flickering in people's homes. And we'll talk about how wind power developers are trying to combat this, but as you can imagine, that would be annoying to live with that. And another impact is the noise. Wind turbines have gotten much quieter over the years as technology has advanced. They don't really make much mechanical noise anymore. However, if you imagine like a misaligned ceiling fan or a ceiling fan at really high speeds, that buffering sound that it makes, the turbines make that same kind of sound, and that obviously would be annoying as well on a day-to-day basis. The second main reason for this debate is exporting electricity. The Irish government has allowed wind farms to be built in Ireland with the sole purpose of sending that electricity overseas, primarily to the United Kingdom. And the Irish people really despise this idea. They don't understand how, when they are not meeting their own EU goals, why they should be sending some of that electricity to other countries. So this was probably a big mistake on the behalf of the federal government to allow this to happen, because it really started turning the tides away from the Irish people supporting wind turbines. And the third is the impact on the landscape and wildlife. Ireland has a lot of cultural sites, these castles that are hundreds of years old, and these cultural groups feel that you should not be able to look at these structures to see in the distance these massive wind turbines towering over them. And then there's also an impact on birds, bats, and other animals. There are tens of thousands of birds killed by being struck by the blades every year, and this is also difficult for bats because their echolocation is thrown off by the buffering of those blades. So these are all impacts that wind power developers have to consider. And so to look at how they do consider that, we'll look at a specific example, which is the Cor Seanabhar wind farm. And this was proposed in 2011 by a wind power developer. They were refused planning permission just a month after their application was received, and appeals have been ongoing. This actually was just heard before the Irish Supreme Court in March of this year, and they're still awaiting that decision. So you can see a 7-year process before they're even allowed to build or break ground on building the turbines. The first step for a developer in getting permission to build a wind farm is to submit an application. And these applications are hundreds of pages long, and they include all of these different assessments and reports. We don't have time to go through all of them, but a few of the most interesting ones to me were the skyline impact. They have to hire a photographer to go out to all the cultural sites, the major roadways, all the homes that can see these turbines, and take panoramic photos. Then they'll go in with drawing software and simulate what the skyline will look like once the wind farm is built. A second assessment is the noise assessment. For each turbine, there has to be an assessment done of wind speeds from 0 to 20 meters per second and in all four cardinal directions. So you're looking at 80 different simulations per turbine, and then they add this on to the baseline measurement, which is taken with these tripod microphones that they deploy and record for a couple weeks to get that baseline ambient noise level, and then they tack on what the turbine will do on top of that. Another assessment is birds and bats. They have to hire a wildlife expert to map the flight paths of birds. So they go out and they sit there for a few days in a sample period. They see where the birds are most likely to fly. They make sure that those migratory bird paths are not going through the turbine blades. And if it's a major bird highway, they call it, then the wind farm really won't be allowed to be built at all. And another major consideration is the bat population. If there are a lot of bats in the area, that wind farm is likely to be rejected because of the impact on that population. We talked about shadow flicker. They also have to simulate this. So for every day of the year, for every time of the day, they have to model the position of the sun in relation to those turbines to see when shadow flicker could be a possibility. And when it is, they have to commit in their application to disabling the turbines during those times. So before the wind farm is even built, they're taking money out of their pocket and restricting when the electricity could be generated. Another thing that's considered is public comment. After the application is received, the community is notified and they are allowed to submit comments for a fee of 20 euros. And this is an interesting decision because that really only encourages negative comments. For this particular one, there were 44 public comments made and all of them were negative, because you're not really likely to shell out that money for a positive comment endorsing the wind farm. You can see the number one concern was the turbines being too close to homes, but there's some other interesting ones on here, like personal health and children's futures being impacted. Things that really don't have a basis or a scientific backing, but the council will have to respond to these and address them in their response because there was a paying citizen that made that comment. Another interesting thing about this particular situation was a really organized opposition. The community came together, founded this opposition group called Windaware Clare that sold merchandise, raised money, and is still involved in these legal proceedings to this day. So because of all these different factors, and especially that organized opposition, they were rejected, that application. And like I said, the appeals are still ongoing, but some of the major reasons that the county rejected this wind farm was wildlife. They felt that the wildlife survey was inadequate. Citizens that live near where the turbines were to be built felt that certain species of birds were ignored altogether. And an interesting one that I found in this response was they didn't like that traffic would be impacted while building the turbines. So for a few days while they had to bring in the heavy equipment, the county didn't like that the roads would be impacted, and that was cited as a whole reason for shutting down this wind farm development. So how does Ireland move forward from this? The first way is the federal government has gotten involved and started warning these counties to knock it off, stop shutting down these developments with such ridiculous reasons. And they have told them that the upper courts will begin overturning these rejections with an increased regularity if they don't start citing some real reasons that actually have an impact on the people. And it's working. The federal government, in order to meet these EU goals, really has to be supportive of onshore wind turbines, and that continues to grow every year. A large number of wind farms are still being built, and as that increases, so does the opposition from the citizens of Ireland. The solution to this from the opposition groups is just build the wind farms out in the ocean, these offshore turbines. The problem with this is they're so expensive that the developer can never make money off of this unless the cost of construction is subsidized by the government. So that's really not an option. The government isn't willing to do that. And so some developers that have been caught in this limbo are just giving up altogether and moving to solar. There's been a big increase in the past few years in solar in Ireland because of these developers that are giving up on wind farms, and they see solar as an easier option where there isn't an organized opposition. In fact, the professor of my course while I was there used to be a wind power developer, but after so many of his projects were rejected and he lost so much money hiring these wildlife experts and other consultants for those applications that never ended up being built, he's given up and moved into the solar industry instead. So that's the current state of the green energy versus green land debate, and I can answer any questions that you have.
Like, what's the difference between like amount of energy produced by solar compared to like the amount of energy produced by windmills?
So in terms of space, it takes a whole lot of rooftops with solar to add up to the megawatts that are coming from like a single wind turbine. And each wind farm typically has like a minimum of 6 turbines. Some are much bigger than that. So it would take many, many rooftops covered in solar to equal the contribution of one turbine.
If I can add to that, a pretty good size, substantial size roof would probably be able to hold maybe a 10 kilowatt system. And these wind turbines, are some of them are upwards of 4 megawatts, right? So we're talking 400 roofs for one turbine, right? Those are the bigger ones, but even like a 2 megawatt, that's 200 roofs for one wind turbine.
I just had a quick question with the shipping the energy to the UK. Do you think, now this was just Ireland itself, not Northern Ireland, which is part of the UK, right? Do you think those politics played a role in that, or you might not have even gotten into that of like?
We got into it a little bit. I think it's interesting that Ireland does not consider sharing energy with Northern Ireland as part of going overseas, even though it is a different country and they're part of the UK. I think it's going to become an even bigger debate as the UK leaves the European Union. So now they're contributing to a country that isn't helping the EU meet its Paris Climate Agreement goals. So that's probably going to increase the opposition to that.
Did you find any, I guess, I don't want to be conspiracy theory-ish, but there's a lot of fossil fuel discussion in that region now, especially with natural gas and all.
Yeah.
So did you find that there was any, if you have a well-organized community, there might be someone backing that?
Yeah, our professor obviously was biased in this, and then he worked in the wind power industry, but he showed us some of those debates, and they bring in these expert people that were opposed to wind turbines, and he'd say, yeah, I know that guy. He runs the natural gas boiler down the street or something. So
yes,
there's definitely some conspiracy stuff there with the wind power opposition. They're not really fighting to save the bats and the birds. They're trying to increase other industries such as natural gas, which is booming. Yeah. Okay, thank you.